Hi, my name is Jonathan Terrell, the intrepid reporter on the beat for Riversource, covering all things land, water, and wildlife for this year's 2021 legislative session and the Youth for a Secure Water and Climate Future program. Today, we're having a conversation about the wildlife issues facing New Mexico now and in the future. I'm joined by Norm Maktima with High Desert Angler and Michael Dax with Defenders of Wildlife. Norm, Michael, it's great to have you. Thanks for joining us.
Glad to be here. I'm a fly fishing guide for a High Desert Angler, been a guide for over 20 years, and have had the opportunity to travel the world. And as a member of Fly Fishing Team USA, which competes in international competitions, on the flip side of that, being Native American, Pueblo descent from Laguna, or San Felipe Laguna and Hopi Pueblos, my culture, you know, inevitably ties into the value of water and what it means, not only to, you know, the evolution of my people, but as well, you know, how we utilize it henceforth on the recreationist side. So I do have a bachelor's in environmental studies, biology from Whitman College, so which required an undergrad thesis, which was on dietary habits of rainbow trout in the Walla Walla River. So, you know, I do have that scientific background as well. So not just telling fly fishing lies and tales and whatnot. There's a little bit of that.
Yeah. Michael, what about you? What's some of your background?
So I work for Defenders of Wildlife here in town. I've been in New Mexico for about 6 years. And Defenders, we're a national nonprofit based in DC that focuses mostly on endangered species. And so we do a lot of work on wolf recovery throughout the West. That's probably what we're known for most.
What are some of those things, whether they be memories or future goals, that continue to drive you to work directly with wildlife and on wildlife issues?
You know, having lived on the Pecos, and I didn't mention that I grew up in Pecos, the town there, and had explored that Pecos watershed pretty much for my whole life growing up. Awesome. You know, seeing the previous mine situation, the old Teredo mine, which growing up was just, you know, the tailings were exposed, you still had open mine shafts, you know, with nobody to take claim over it and do any reclamation work until, mid-90s, you know, we had a pretty significant rainy event. And, you know, all that was washing the river and, you know, just created a big problem, big mess. And then finally, as a Superfund project, the mine definitely had funding and was, you know, big reclamation project was implemented. You know, it was always told to me that nothing is ours really forever. We're only borrowing things. And so that goes with knowledge and information, you know, so I have had the opportunity to gain a lot of this knowledge and information from people who were willing to give it to me without asking for anything. So, you know, that has driven me to, in turn, give that knowledge and information and passion back to really the youth more than anything. You know, we're seeing.
You know, I think the Terrero mine that Norm rigs up is, you know, really a perfect example. And, you know, locally, you know, it's hard to find a better one that's more timely. But I'd also say, as far as creating policy that is really lasting, it's important that we build big coalitions, especially in New Mexico, where we have a lot of diverse cultures, we have a lot of diverse land uses. You know, agriculture in the northern part of the state is very different than agriculture in the southern part of the state. And when it comes to the threats that we're facing, especially drought, and we're in a historic drought right now, you know, these are things that affect all of us. We might be coming at it from a slightly different angle, but the fact is that, you know, whether or not you're a fly fisherman or a farmer, you know, drought is going to affect you. And so, you know, making sure that we're, you know, bringing in all those voices and crafting policy that's going to be durable through political shifts and realizing those common values.
What are some things that we can do to sort of help communities minimize their impact on wildlife corridors, whether it's at the state or regional level?
Development in, you know, almost any sense, whether that's residential development, energy development, whether it's, you know, renewables or oil and gas, you know, new roads, things like that, all have the potential to impact wildlife. And what New Mexico is doing now, really for the first time, is they're collaring animals. They're putting GPS collars on elk, deer, pronghorn, so we understand where they're moving, both on a day-to-day basis, but also throughout the year, you know, moving from high elevation areas in the summertime down to low elevation areas in the wintertime, right, and planning around that. So we're, you know, we're not cutting off those corridors. Then, you know, for species like pronghorn don't jump, weirdly enough. They're the fastest land mammal in North America, but they don't jump. So what we've discovered, what scientists have discovered, is that they'll go under fences, but they need at least 16 inches of clearance between the ground and that bottom wire. Wow. So there are a lot of places where fences could be retrofitted to be more pronghorn friendly.
Sure.
And then one other example, right now, the New Mexico Department of Game and Fish and New Mexico Department of Transportation are putting together a wildlife corridors action plan. And included in that will be a list of priority safe passage projects.
Nice.
Things like underpasses and overpasses that will allow wildlife to cross roadways safely, both for them and for drivers. And what I'm really excited and really hopeful for is the state's first overpass.
Norm, do you have any thoughts?
I hope to see that that influx of people going and utilizing trailheads and utilizing bike trails or campsites, camp areas, you know, will also get put back into maybe perhaps more of that education, more of that conservation, more of that riparian restoration work, campsite development, you know, just those factors that will help mitigate the impact of the influx of people. It's great that people are getting out there. And the one thing too is about, you know, having this whole situation within, that's what's happening in the world, you know, from politics to COVID to, you know, closures to separation of families, you know, you have all of these components that are affecting the wellness of people overall. Getting outside is such a healing aspect, you know.
Yeah. And what are some things that you are excited about relative to wildlife?
So there are a couple bills that I'll be tracking. One will be from Senator Mimi Stewart to restrict the use of neonicotinoid pesticides, which are very harmful to pollinators, especially bees. And that's one where, you know, again, this, you know, thinking about this foundational relationship with the natural world, over the past couple decades, we've started to really appreciate how important pollinators are to just the functioning of everything. And this goes to, you know, pollinating food that, you know, we all rely on. So, you know, food security issues to, you know, wildflowers and kind of everything else. It is one of these basic building blocks. So that legislation this will be the first year it will be heard, and definitely excited for that. And then there will be another, bill, that will be a kind of an omnibus wildlife reform package. One, you know, it'll do a lot of different things. One thing it will do will, change the name of New Mexico Department of Game and Fish to the New Mexico Wildlife Department. And, you know, largely that's somewhat symbolic, but I think it does reflect some of these themes that we've discussed so far today of, you know, not just thinking of wildlife as a resource for our taking, but thinking of it in a much more holistic sense of, you know, having its own inherent value. You know, some, you know, Norm talking about, you know, you know, when you catch a fish, you know, minimizing the impact to that fish when you catch it and put it back. You know, that's just that, you know, relationship with those species of, you know, being very grateful. It's not just for our consumption. It is for, you know, that fish has value as a sentient being in and of itself. So, you know, it's somewhat symbolic, but, you know, I think it also helps reframe how we think about these resources.
And so, Norm, Do you have any thoughts?
You know, if you are passionate about the outdoors, look to your elders, talk to them about their experiences, their history, their knowledge, the stories, you know, you know, obviously we're losing more and more of those folks, and that knowledge and history is leaving with them. You know, even on the flip side is just, really do your diligence in understanding how these ecosystems tie together, how the communities tie together. And, you know, and I had that ability as an environmental studies major, you know, was just understanding how a lot of environmental impact and work, how it really thrives on that communication between communities, between people. And so not only look to your own elders, but, you know, have that communication with other people.
So I want to thank you guys both, Norm and Michael. It was great to have you.
About social media earlier, I'm on Facebook, Instagram, my YouTube channel is N Maktima Flyfishing, which is also my other social media.
I also run a hiking website, so the website is nmtrails.org.
I'm Jonathan Terrell, beat reporter for Riversource and the Youth for a Secure Water Future program, signing off.